I don't know what to say, you know, and that's unusual. So I am going to say thank you, David, for that. And I had not remembered that I had pasted Rilke's Archaic Torso of Apollo to my bookshelf, although I was in the habit of doing things like that. So I can pretty much support or verify what David was saying. He wasn't an hallucination. And I kept that poem with me in many ways for the very same reasons that David cited just then, that it's always been part of my understanding of an experience of art, that it looks at you and asks you, you know, who you are, as much as you looking at it and saying, what do you mean? Things on that order. And so I want to say thank you, David, for that, remembering that. Thank you for inviting me. It's a great honor. Thank you all in this community. I love the school. I sat in the car for a few minutes before I came in and just breathed deeply. And it is such a good air in this green field that that you live in and think and read and write in. I'm going to not stand behind this. I'm going to stand here if it's okay with everybody. Voice clear enough? Good. And I want to bring my stuff around. I've got a bunch of material that I want to work with. But first and foremost, I would like to honor Archie, and I'm part of his posse, in case you didn't know. I know. Give, you know, a little smile, a little laughter, thank you. You know, and you know, and I think this is really lovely. And you'll see, weirdly and yet not, this is exactly the theme I had sort of figured out for a reading today. And it's true, I did say a weekend ago or so, who doesn't love short poems? We were giving a presentation at the Mass Poetry Festival, and my colleagues, Jenny Barber and David Ferry, and one of our undergraduates who was graduating, we all presented short poems and our thoughts about them. So having said that, one of the things you can love about short poems is that you can memorize them. This is from Archie. It's called Autumn. You ready? Autumn. Sun smudge on the smoky water. Who doesn't love short poems? Sun smudge on the smoky water. Autumn. That wasn't what I came to read. I had that lined up, but I wasn't going to read that. But since David cited the short poem, what I wanted to read were a couple of poems of his that, and as I was looking through things yesterday, I think, what do I want to read of his? I noticed that more than a couple, maybe a half dozen to a dozen of his poems have dedications to other writers or about other writers. There's something in his imagination in which he wants to acknowledge the presence of other writers. This is not an easy poem, what I'm going to read. It's called Poet's Laughter. I'll try to get the sound of it right, but I'm not totally sure I've got it right. But it's called Poet's Laughter, and it references the Chinese poet from the 8th century, Li Po. Poet's Laughter. Why do I live among green mountains? Said Li Tai Po. I laugh and do not answer. I'm going to start that again. He's speaking. That all of that is in quotes, right? Except for the said Li Tai Po. All right? Poet's Laughter. Why do I live among green mountains? Said Li Tai Po. I laugh and do not answer. You laughed a long time ago, Li Po, and men laugh with you still, but do they know better than him you laughed at long ago just why you lived among green mountains? Isn't that great? You laughed a long time back, Li Po, and men laugh with you still, but do they know better than him you laughed at long ago just why you lived among green fields? Thank you. And then another poem that I saw that I just said, it's so interesting, from Archie, called Poet. And it's for Ernest Hemingway, with whom he was pals, and probably did more than a little bit of drinking and fishing. All right? Poet, for Ernest Hemingway. There must be moments when we see right through although we say we can't. I knew a fisher who could lean and look blind into dazzle on the sea and strike into that fire his hook far under and lean back and laugh and let the line run out and reel what rod could weigh nor line could feel the heavy silver of his wish, and when the reel spool faltered, kneel, and with a fumbling hand that shook, boat all bloody from the gaff, a shivering fish. And I do like the way in which that poem lifts the fish out of the water, almost auditorially, you know, by almost by ear. That's the sort of the feel of the poem. And I want to read one last little thing. I was here 4 years ago, we figured it out, and gave a lecture on MacLeish's Poetry and Experience, a book that was very important to me in my own coming of age as a writer. And it was a book that really did affirm, in his language of, say, 1950s, when he was giving those lectures at Harvard, so we all understand now writing is a process. But, you know, it wasn't so easy for anyone to talk that way, you know, in full lecture mode at Harvard in the 1950s. It was much more, you know, a kind of top-down wisdom. But he held out constantly for the idea that writing was a process and that writers learned how to write with that in mind. He said in one of his interviews, in this really terrific book, by the way, which Ben can take partial credit for, the following. There is no way in the world by which one human being can teach another human being how to practice an art. What you can do is to say at the very personal level, I remember having had the kind of problem you had getting across from the end of that paragraph to the beginning of the next one. And I remember how I worked that, and I'll tell you about it. And then that works out into a conversation. And he may learn something from it. He may not. Honestly, I think it was such profound wisdom, you know, really in that observation of understanding what it meant to try to teach writing. Well, so what I thought as I was putting this reading together is I thought I'll read some of the poems that I have from several books over the course of my life in which I've sort of either dedicated the poems to another poet or a teacher or someone who, you know, meant something like that to me, whether in person or on the page. And in the spirit, you know, of Archie's posse. And it's clear that he was a friend to many. And many thought of him as a friend, and I think that's true. You know, I didn't know him, but in practical, real-life terms, you know, he was a friend to writers, and writers were, you know, aware of how good and generous his sense of things was. As David referenced in his really beautiful introduction, that when I graduated from college, it was 1968, and I ended up joining the Marine Corps. And there was lots of sort of irrationalities were at play. Part of it, though, was an irrationality about writing and about my vocation. I thought I was being called on to go to the war to write about it. Don't even ask, all right? I can explain, but it'll take the whole rest of our time together. And it would be worthwhile. I don't, you know, dispute that. But I want to focus on some poetry. It was many years later that I came of age as a writer in my mid-40s, to be honest, starting around age 35. It took me a long time to get over all of that. And around 35 to the next 10 years, I sort of really engaged in an apprenticeship. But in the process of doing that, I reflected upon some of my teachers. And I had a couple of really extraordinary experiences as an undergraduate with a couple of poets who were pretty well known. And they did hover around this question about joining the damn Marine Corps, wanting to, you know, go to the war, not having enough of a sense of you know, of the moral and ethical, you know, dilemmas that I would face, and did, you know, eventually. And I should say, I always feel this moment of honesty and integrity is really important, that I didn't go to the war. I left the Marine Corps on Okinawa after 2 years in. And I first visited Vietnam in 1994. And it was out of purely literary reasons, I'm happy to say. And so I feel very lucky to say it too. However, there I was a year after graduation. My teacher at Brown was a poet named Edwin Hoenig. Edwin was a really fine poet, he's passed away now. He's a really fine poet. He's also a very, very famous translator of poetry by Fernando Pessoa, the Portuguese poet, and of Spanish poets and playwrights. He wrote the first biography in America, published in America, of Lorca. And he did that in 1946 or 47 after World War II when he came home. And that was his PhD, actually. That's how he got academic jobs after that. Anyway, Edwin was my teacher, my first poetry workshop teacher. And I had orders to go overseas, and I was home visiting my parents, and I decided to call him up on a Sunday morning. I was supposed to leave from Boston the next day. I was in Providence. I called him up, and I said, Edwin, I just wanted to say goodbye and, so on. And he said, why don't you come over for breakfast, for brunch? Because Robert Lowell is here. And Robert Lowell was staying with him overnight because the local Trinity Square Repertory Theater had just put on a trilogy of plays by Lowell called The Old Glory. And there were a bunch of writers. So I go over to Edwin's house and, you should know also, you should all know that Robert Lowell also was a conscientious objector in World War II. And he was extraordinarily, as a poet, extraordinarily public and active in his opposition to the Vietnam War. This is called CO, and that's the sort of abbreviation for conscientious objector. Ironically enough, also the abbreviation for commanding officer, but that's an accident. CO, and it's an in memoriam poem, an elegy for Robert Lowell, but it's more than that as well. And it's set over at Edwin's house. CO. Cold scrambled eggs, burnt bacon curling under his slightly cockeyed glasses. Opera on the stereo. The bay ice flat and gray as a naval deck. The shore rimy and swirling with snow. Gusts rising up to us, a window rattling behind us. I can breathe out here. A Sunday in November 1969, the morning after Trinity Square mounted his Old Glory trilogy. Bloody Mary toasts with celery stick swizzles, Worcestershire, horseradish, fiery talk about the Narragansetts and the colonials who were slavers. To the sun porch, beaming with poets, I carry with me a shadowy prosaic, orders to Vietnam. A green lieutenant, shave-headed as a monk. I leave tomorrow and cannot fathom Lowell's question about the green berets, his breath chopping the word into hardly intelligible halves. He takes over and pictures the pajamaed gorilla, as in Jiyui, the gorilla fighter, the pajamaed gorilla flying out the rear hatch of the helicopter. He asks me if I've seen this, and he assumes I know more than I'm saying. Me, now the dim, lumpen, and enemy soldier, pleading innocence, ignorance, dismay. It is as if a vacuum has sucked up the straight talk. And under his affronted glare, I feel like Hawthorne's young Robin Molyneux, bewildered by Boston's mocking, checker-faced hostility. I, too, am blistered by the moment and can't believe this has happened. The china clinks. Talk slowly resumes while I come to, blinking like a hammered calf. I hardly know the abbreviation CO, but a conscience must be at work when he leans over and whispers, come back, intact. The rhyme nearly full and the orders fully meant. Now there's a little bit of fiction in that, and first of all, you should know, and you may not know, that in the Vietnam War era, there was this terrible revelation that sometimes captured prisoners were interrogated by taking three up in a helicopter and tossing two people out to make the other guy talk. So that's what he's referring to, Lowell was. Lowell was rather a tall man, and Edmund Honig was also, and I was leaving the house. And when he confronted me at the table in front of everybody and made me into the Secretary of Defense at that moment, as if I were responsible for the whole war, I said, oh man, I'm getting out of here as soon as I can. Well, talk resumed, and I got the hell out of there. And I got to the door, and I'm standing there saying goodbye to Edwin. And actually, it would be nice to write this maybe in prose sometime, but Edwin is giant-sized, and I don't see anything but a flash behind him. But it's Lowell rushing out of the sun porch and poking his head around Edwin and making this effort to say, come back intact. It was when I first was, Robert Lowell died when I first was at Suffolk teaching courses such as what David was talking about. In fact, David was my second year of teaching, maybe my third year of teaching in college. And Robert Lowell died, I think, in 1977, 78. And I was actually, during the funeral, I was teaching a class. And I remember thinking, I hadn't written that, you know. I remember thinking, God, I really should cancel class and get the hell out of here and go to that funeral. But I didn't. I'm sure it was okay. Actually, I'm going to leave the conscientious objector moment alone for a minute, but take another short poem out of this first book. And several of the poems in this book were begun at Squaw Valley, right, community of writers in California. And I was in my, I don't know, maybe 42 or so. I mean, I wasn't a kid, and I wasn't really, you know, I thought of myself as writing, but I didn't know exactly, didn't think of myself as a writer. I was still a student of writing. And I went to that summer workshop, very intense week, with great teachers, and one of whom was Robert Haas. Some of you may have read Robert Haas's poetry. And Haas he liked short poems, and he used to often do this great haiku by Basho, Busan. You stay, I go, two autumns. And, you know, I'll do it again. You stay. No, you go, I stay. We can switch it around. You go, I stay. Two autumns. You remember MacLeish's poem, you can add it to it. And you've got a nice collage of short poems there, don't you? So, this is a poem in my first book that doesn't reference Bob Haas. It should. It does reference the great haiku, Japanese haiku, poet of the 18th century, the 16th century, I think, Busan. And for those of you who know and love Robert Frost's poem, there's actually a secret homage to Robert Frost inside of this poem. It's a short poem. Lines after Busan. We were, and there were many of us then, talking about leaving. You mentioned his haiku. You leave, I stay, two autumns. And I felt the chill of the ice skimmed off the birdbath and its beauty, as if we held it up as lens. You said leaving should make us more alert to loss, and that being was in some way attention. The color of it bleeds now into sunlight and onto every leaf. I bend down for a bright one. Even the ice disappears. Now, does anyone know, I forget the Robert Frost poem, I stole the image, not exactly the lines, but he has a poem about skimming going to a barrel and skimming the ice off the top of it, holding it up and looking, you know. Thank you, is it After Applepig? Yeah, and I'm sorry, I said, you know, I love the image and I don't feel bad about it. I feel like, thank you. Right? And I felt like there is a sense of the posse, if you will, right? That sense of, and I know that you folks are studying, you know, and I know that one of the sort of inheritances every young writer certainly engages in or has to deal with, and maybe all of us all the time, is this sort of weird sense of American individualism. You know, that, and it's sort of romantic, you know, that you are inspired and it's you and you're blessed and you're special and you are. You know, all of that's true. Problem is, it's not true enough. and it's not enough, it's not all the whole story, then in some way, whatever art means, it is this interchange between you and it, another writer in you, another piece, somebody else's words in you. And David, I smile as I remember myself saying things too often, but David might remember. It was around the time I met David that I was reading Octavio Paz, a great Mexican poet, and there's an essay in which he says, and I distort it, I deliberately distort it, he doesn't say it quite as clearly as this, the real poem, the full poem, is a circle, one half of which the reader creates. And what he means by that is that not everything is up for grabs, you know? There is half the circle written, right? But what he means is that the real, the artwork itself consists of you and another human being making it. You know, its full self is made that way. I'm going to move on to another book now. So at a certain point in around that time of Squaw Valley, I also started studying with William Stafford, and a poet who's not so well known nowadays anymore, but in the late 20th century was absolutely extraordinarily well known. And, you know, literary reputations rise and fall. But he, in addition to his poetry, which I love to this moment, he was also a very great teacher, and like Archibald MacLeish, you know, lowered the temperature, so to speak, about what it meant to write. And that it wasn't sort of like you having to be inspired. It meant that you had to put one word down and see what that word said to you to find the next word. And there was that sense in which a writer was always in the act of discovering what she or he was going to write or say. And so he was very important to me, and I studied with him in workshops for a few years, and, you know, later became friends. And then after he passed away, I did that editing, and I also helped his son do his memoir, and you know, have a great sort of lifelong affiliation with Bill Stafford. Well, when he did pass away, I wrote an elegy, and it's called Estuary. And you know what an estuary is, right? It's the way in which various kinds of water courses meet, you know, with the big water course, you know, at the ocean, that kind of thing. So these are four moments recollected of being with Bill Stafford. Estuary. Early for the reading, I studied the statue of Washington. I should say, who's been to the Wall Street, where that museum is? There's a statue of Washington outside the place where Washington said goodbye to his troops at the end of the Revolutionary War, and there's a little museum in there. And Bill Stafford gave a reading there, and I went down to hear him. So, early for the reading, I studied the statue of Washington, sat on the stone sill. Then strolled the block with children on a school trip, came back to sit with workers eating lunch. When you began, you recalled waking to rain, old northwestern friend, pressed against the high ridge of your hotel. You said it made for a long guessing at what lay beyond. Roaring jets, trucks, unmuffled dumpsters, clanging the hoot of river tugs, the city din. First to mind was not our almost fatal excess, but a delight in the hints of our world breathing. A dark, wet gravel clinking underfoot. It's not the same place, by the way. That's why two was meant part two. A dark, wet gravel clinking underfoot, a fledgling eagle in the spruce, indifferent but unable to let anything pass. You opening the jalousy door, new work in your hand, the page flipping as if it were a salmon, culled, arching, lifted up, out, still alive. A tanager swayed on a gnarled juniper and listened in, but a small stone clicked down and the bird fled, while we, mutable in our flesh, shivered in the early snow. The heavens over the Wasatch were breaking into columns of light, and without a word you started up the scree as if you knew the next place we'd have to meet would be at the top. Among the fragrant juniper, a continent away, there is a stream lively with steelhead. I imagine you now, your wandering thought, making a small joining at the far reaches with mine. just beyond our lines of sight where the jagged point, the strong emissary of the land, goes gray with fog and gives itself over to the ocean, to the long combers, where, wave-scoured and almost invisible, a cedar log rolls in on every single one, and then back. You know, I have this terrible habit of being so happy to have the poem in the world and you listening, even though it's really sad. Right? I feel sad. Even I haven't felt sadness like that about Bill for a long while, you know? But also I think, God, I hope he likes this, you know? So there's that. I'm only going to read one section of another four-part poem that is in this book. And you can see the book's colors are kind of, this is a painting by Gregory Aminoff, and it's based on William Blake's poem Starry Night, and he's got a series of 12 paintings that he does various things with. But ironically and completely unintentionally, I mean, I had nothing to do with this down here, but ironically enough, this is very reminiscent of the Vietnamese flag. You may see, you know, a red background and a bright yellow star in the center of it. Well, ironically, this book records in my life my encounter with Vietnamese culture at a very serious level. That is to say, through writers and meeting other poets in another context altogether. That country, but also another cultural context, another cultural paradigm. And so much of this book is informed, and the book sort of goes back and forth between that meaning of the other and, you know, my trying to understand what life was doing with me, what I was doing with it. So the title of it, the book, comes from a poem called Full Moon Boat. It's another four-part lyric. And that title comes from a line from Ho Chi Minh, who was himself a poet. And he says in this poem, it's in one of his New Year's Eve poems, every year he would write one, "Yes, sell the compass and come on the boat of the full moon." And it was one of those poems designed to inspire those gorillas, you know, in the jungle, right? And, you know, and he said, you don't need, you know, all the fancy equipment. Just use the moon, right? So I just thought it was such an interesting thought anyway. And so I made this four-part homage to poets that I knew in that country. And the poet that David mentioned, the poet that I, with another friend, Vietnamese friend, translated, Tran Dang Khoa, is the poet who's at in the last of the four, and I'll read that. Tran Dang Khoa, in the years of the American War, was a boy prodigy of a poet. His mother and father both were illiterate. They were farmers. One of his uncles was a high school teacher, and that's how Khoa became really interested in studying and writing and whatnot. But early on, I mean, probably around age 9, he wrote a poem that the local newspaper published. And this is the years in which bombing, you know, the B-52s are dropping bombs all over North Vietnam. He's about 50 kilometers south of Hanoi. And the riverway near his house is being bombed on a daily basis. The bridge doesn't exist, and what troops come across it on a raft, a barge, at night. During the daytime, they hide out in the farm area. So Khoa, he writes lots of poems, mostly about the agricultural life of his country and his village, and becomes famous. The newspapers pick them up like syndicates, and he's celebrated. By the time he's 12, he's celebrated, 12, as being the spirit of the country. You know, that the agricultural cycle, for instance, will continue despite the war. And anyway, he sends at age 12 a set of 20 poems to Ho Chi Minh, makes his own chapbook, for those of you who know what chapbooks are. Sends it to Ho Chi Minh. Ho Chi Minh says, do not let this kid come to the capital. He'll get a big head. Make sure he stays out there in the country, right? And it's true, according to all these legends, it's true. He didn't. Youngsters start memorizing his poems. And he becomes really a kind of spirit of resistance to the war inside that country. Flash forward so many years. That chapbook is lost. Poems are all known and published, but the actual document that he sent to Ho Chi Minh is lost and is found, actually, inside the Ho Chi Minh Museum in a case without an identifying marker. And a friend of mine, and my friend Khoa and some other folks, knew what it was when they saw it. And so they asked us to, my friend, the two of us, to translate it. We did this work. And that's a long introduction to a poem about Khoa and how the first time I met him, he took us near his village, not into his village. That was a little bit too sacred, but to the river crossing near his village. Well, when I say myself and friends on this group. And so this is the last part of Full Moon Boat. It's called the Kin Tai Ferry. Kin Tai is the name of that riverway. It's part of the Red River collection of rivers in northern Vietnam. The Kin Tai Ferry. We think they are crossing. Here, where the bombs fell under the cries of the stork, where dike walls are alive with winter grasses, we think they are crossing again. On the slope where the pavement ends and willows are thin arms in the wind, a woman squats by her bicycle, a rice bale strapped to its rack, too heavy to push. We think they are crossing here, just beyond the lotus growing in the bomb crater ponds, just beyond the ferry's dented bow, our own arms pushing with her now. I'll let that one just be. I'm going to read a poem now that comes out of another kind of set of literary friendships, mostly having to do with Ireland. I published a book of poetry in Ireland, and the publisher was a man named John F. Dean, himself a really fine poet and translator and novelist, and for many years the founder and the director of Daedalus Press in Dublin. And John took a liking to my work at the Joyner Center, where he was a guest one summer. So he published a book, selected poems, and some new poems. But then over the years, our conversation deepened. You know, in fact, I have his manuscript on my desk, his most recent I've got to read and respond to. And he taught me many things. I was brought up a Catholic, and he was too. He was almost a priest, and I wasn't, put it that way. But, you know, there's sort of like, there's a little secular and profane part of me that he finds appealing, and I find his religious sensibility very, very appealing. Now, you know, but I'm not that, you know. So he published a book called Manhandling the Deity a few years ago. And it was a book that really had him struggling with his idea of God, right? And so I wrote him a poem. It's called Credo, which of course means, you know, faith, my faith, right? In Latin. Credo. It's for John F. Dean. Unholy in the beginning. I'm going to stop. So there's something wonderful about the visual fact of poetry, right? That unholy, by the way, has quote marks on it. It's a quote from him. His book begins with the word unholy, and it ends with symphony, all right? And those are quote marks around them, so you can see, all right? Credo, unholy in the beginning, and symphony to end, manhandling the deity. Your roughed up book path through gate and garden, through fields of gorse and bog cotton, and a world stilled for a second as if it had stopped breathing. An instant in which the heart floats like a planet on nothing. The eyes are open, eager for a flensing. Reason is pared down to a pulse and held off for the less than an instant the words need to thread one soul to the next. I believe in such strange, incomplete rhymes, in words alone and what lives in between them. And you can see, I designed the poem so there'd be lots of room for that, right? Lots of space in between the lines and the words so they can. So David was kind enough to mention Said Not Said, which is the new manuscript. It's going to be out now. It'll be 11 months from now, in April next, in 2017. But that's what I mean, Said Not Said. All right? And no commas. I don't know what it means. But, of course, as Archie says, you know, a poem should what?
Mean.
Thank you. No.
Not mean,
but be. And I think that what came to me yesterday as I was looking through my material, I said, I just realized that it really has been a constant in my writing life. In every collection I put together, there have been a number of poems in which I really tried to recognize that connection to other writers. It's been absolutely essential to me. And so I'm going to end by reading a couple of poems on that count. And the first one I'm going to read is another poem to John Dean, although it's not really to him, it's about him or me and him. And it's set in Ireland, and it's, how many people here know about these passage tombs, the prehistoric beehive tombs in Ireland? You know, they're these sort of earlier than recorded history, maybe, the ceremonial burial grounds. There were these mounds that have been excavated. The most famous is at Newgrange. And John and I went to go visit the one at Newgrange, and the crowds were like a national park. You couldn't get in. We didn't want to wait. But he knew of another one, a lesser one, that was not even recognized as, you know, you didn't have to pay to get in. You had to hop a fence where the sheep were. it's at Knowth, Knowth. And this is called Passage Tomb, and it is for John Dean. Dayglow brands on the sheep. Barbed wire gates we barely slip through. A green pasture mound. Afterthought rubble where we peer in. Our eyes adjusting to stones shaped like the lives we imagine it took to heft the granite into canopy. I'd like to pry the whole thing apart. Brush away the dirt, peel the mica from quartz, find the flecks of light, and ask how deep the vein goes. This desire to work ore into metal, to hammer metal down to blade, to run a thumb down the edge, draw a little blood, and say to yourself, not bad. Bends in the passage, dust puffs underfoot, a few places where the water seeps in from the pasture above, the dank air that seems to rush up toward you and push back. None of these have anything to say about the matter. Or if they do, it must happen deeper down and in a chamber off to the side where the eyes no longer do you any good and fingers are all you have left to see with, where fear rebounds off the walls and offers to guide you back out. I visited Israel-Palestine a few years ago in a delegation sponsored by Interfaith Peace Builders, a group from Washington, D.C. that makes a commitment to visit people on both sides of that terrible, intractable conflict who are committed to nonviolent responses to it. So that's what the delegation was to visit people in both the West Bank and in Israel proper. And one of the people I spent an afternoon with was a man named Giuliano Mirkamis. Giuliano was a really handsome actor, famous actor in Israel. His mother she was Jewish, Israeli. She married a Palestinian. They lived in Jenin during the Intifadas. In any case, she was a theater person. And Giuliano, after the second Intifada, after the first Intifada, went back to Jenin, gave up his acting career, and founded what he called the Freedom Theater in Jenin. 2012, he was assassinated. And no one knows to this day, you know, why. I mean, there were lots of theories, like he was doing things that angered the fundamentalists in the Jenin refugee camp, you know, because he had women in plays. At the same time, of course, the IDF, the Israeli Defense Force, had him assassinated, because he was, in fact, you know, an activist, a nonviolent activist, but an activist nevertheless, and incredibly well-known and famous. And then there were rumors that he gambled too much, like gangsters killed him. So even to this moment, no one has yet really pinpointed the cause of Giuliano's assassination. However, I opened my computer up one morning to learn it, and here is what the mind does. Here is what the mind does when my laptop opens to a small red car, a tight street in Jenin, gray-yellow dust, an electric window half open, and five lean-to cards where on each number, each a number denotes a round spent or where it began to travel at the speed of its sense of the truth, while by an open car the blood pools and follows a tilt in the road, as if more lingering, as if blood could choose not to leave, could hang around, be curious and puzzled like the children who stop to watch men who have duties do them as quickly as they can in a slow, reluctant, and deliberate picking through, which is what the mind does at moments like this. Really, little more than nothing. And I want to show you the title of that poem. You can see it's in italics. And that title comes from a poem, is a line from a poem by another poet named Carl Kirchwey. And I read this poem, and I don't know where I read it, I think it was the New Yorker. I read this poem, and in the vicinity of the day or two after, I opened my own laptop up to see Giuliano's death recorded, and I said to myself, here is what the mind does, you know, and I've given Carl credit in a footnote, but and he knows this, but that's the title of the poem is Carl Kirchwey's own line. I'm going to end with another elegy, perhaps not as grim as that one. This is an elegy for Seamus Heaney, and I want to say that I don't think that I first heard Seamus Heaney's name from David Ram. But this is a really important dimension of teaching. It's what you learn from your students that you often carry away and becomes really very much a part of you. And I remember David coming to me in my office and saying, I've just been reading these poems by Seamus Heaney. You know, and I said, yeah, and I knew a few, you know, and I hadn't really, really studied them. You know, and David was writing poems himself. And I think I said to you, David, I hope I'm not, you know, making this up pure legend. I think I said to David, David, go see him. He's got office hours. Go talk to him. Well, those of you who know Professor Ram know that saying something like that to him was not something that he would sort of let, you know, slide. He said, hell yeah, I'm going to go do it. And he did. In fact, he came back a week or two later and said, yeah, I was just with Seamus Heaney talking. I don't know what you said, but I'm making it up now. But I know that David went and visited with Seamus. And over the years later, I did become very close to Seamus. And he was very much a friend. You know, and he remembers people coming over from Suffolk, you know, to talk to him. And he was really happy to meet people, you know, to young writers, I mean, you know, not just everybody, right? I mean, he wasn't saying, like, you know, come on for a drink. But, you know, but young writers, you know, that's what he was there for. And so I want to thank David, you know, for humanizing Seamus Heaney for me. And also, I'm sure, doing the same for many of you. With so many different kinds of poets and poetry. I also want to thank, you know, Archie, right? Okay? And I do think that this is a posse. This is a poem called Fennel. And there's an epigraph by a Brazilian Portuguese poet, a woman named Adelia Prado. And the poem actually, Ellen Watson gave the reading here last time. It's her translation of Adelia Prado. The soul, yes, was murky, and no one could see it. Fennel, and it's for Seamus Heaney. Something of the fog is burned off, something in the high oaks and behind the sounds of hammers, ignitions, a shift outward, a quick, long view to a sliver of the largest bay there is. A morning of pinion and stridor. Of course, you were not one who was for the high air and only remote. You were for the light on the table, the red gate that needed to be shut, the irritable dog that hears the world too much. The scruffy, fledgling robin that lands on the trellis sizes me up in the way of its kind and decides I am all right, just more evidence of oddity found among the breathing. At the end, maybe you were thinking of Whitman and his claim that dying was luckier than we had supposed. Or not. Or not. Here is the bee that hovers over a newly fallen leaf. How lovely the flower, I do not know, and where do I enter? I remember cresting the ancient hill at Dunkaneely, seeing a blue caravan in the pasture corner and thinking this is all I will ever know of the soul. The grass uncut, a land arm stretching out to the south. I touch it again here in the braille of small yellow blooms I rub between my fingers, pass under my nose, while a snail with its horns of light works its way down the stem. Anybody want to ask a question? Honestly and truly, I do feel that everything I said has its own sort of history to it. But, nothing is sacred here. Everything's open. You want to ask any questions, I'm okay with it.
Could you talk a little bit about your own writing process?
Let me quote Bill Stafford and then tell you how it works itself out in my life. At the beginning of his essay called A Way of Writing, he says, a writer is not so much someone who has something to say as he, as his time is era saying that, he or she has found a way to say something they would not have thought of if they hadn't started to say it. Now, I've actually done, for workshops, I've actually given that lineation. I've done line breaks on that one, on the clauses, actually, so that we can see what he's... But what he was saying is that, that you don't know what you're going to do, but you have to start doing it, and the doing of it will teach you something about what you're going to do. That is, in fact, at the heart of my own writing process, that I don't really know. I think the hardest thing in the world for me as a writer is actually getting out of that comfort zone of not knowing. I'm happy when I don't know. Okay, really great. Let's see where the words go. Let's see what happens. And sometimes that's, just swirls around. It's lots of fun, but sometimes I got to bring another mindset into it. Say, okay, what the hell is this all about? And that's usually the moment I leave my handwritten material, whether it's in a journal or a piece of paper, and go to the computer. And that's sort of the moment in which I've decided that I sense the presence of a potential poem somewhere down the road. Doesn't mean I've got one, but it does mean, okay, I'm not just swirling, not just having, occasionally, a poem will come to me almost fully there. I might end on one, actually, the one that's in the program. That came to me almost as is, only struggled with the last line of it. But that's so rare, and that's a blessing. And it's great, but it doesn't, it's not how you live. So for my money and my life, my well-being as a human being, it's really important that I write as much as I can in that sort of unencumbered way, unshackled way. You can call it free writing, you can call it journaling. It doesn't matter what one calls it, but that we all know what it means not to have any responsibility except to the language in front of you, right? In your imagination, whatever's going on in your brain. Good or bad too, that's also true. However, there's another far-end answer to the question, and that is, after all of that good stuff has happened, and I'm somewhere around the middle of my 60 revisions of the poem. And I'm not kidding. And that's why they invented Save As with Microsoft Word, all right? It's a lot easier to keep your versions if you want, all right? You're going to change it, and it's a significant change. Save As, and then you go on to the next one, right? I really do work... at my best level, I think, in these microclimates of the end of the, when the poem is reaching its full self, like little adjustments toward the end, not the end of the poem, but toward the end of the process, little adjustments for me mean everything. I want to say, holy shit, really is something. If you change one word, you know, and all of a sudden the poem springs into focus. And I've had this happen so many times, and us emeritus professors can talk this way. You know, I since I haven't been teaching full time and doing grades and everything, and I've been working on this manuscript, I've had this experience so much so I can study it. I know it's part of my writing process, that there's this wonderful beginning, this sort of William Stafford beginning. But there's this other part that comes toward the end of that process that I'm going to say it, that I'm really good at, but it takes me forever. You know, I have to go through, I almost have to do everything by a process of elimination. I eliminate all the bad ways I could do something until I do, until I finally find it. So that's the span for me. Now you might be asking, do I do it every day? No. William Stafford, you know, is my super ego conscience that he wrote every day and he wrote early in the morning. And I say to myself, I should be, and you know, and but I'm a sinner. And I don't, exactly, right. You know, and so, you know, but I love, what I've really been trying to sort of learn about my own life as a writer is that I really love it, even though it's difficult and I hate it. But I was going to say to those who are writing poems, you know, that I really mean this as a friend of your enterprise, that, you know, that you're not on your own. You know, as much as your individual suffering and joy, you know, is the material of your poetry, the art itself is actually something that, you know, comes with, you know, a history. You know, there's really a whole lot of people who have worked on poems before you, and they've been struggling with those things. And then there's also a future. I mean, there's, you know, like if you don't do the poem, that if you've got something you really want to write about and you can't get to it, you can't figure out how to do it, you know, God willing, you know, you'll live. And there'll be time, and you'll learn more about poems. And who knows, when some sliver will come into, some sliver of my poem, something I said today will come sliding into the poem. And boom, you know, that it's not that it solves the problem, but it helps, that the other writer often helps throw something into relief, help you see something, you know, that you haven't seen before, or hear something, you know, in a way that you haven't heard before.
MacLeish had a couple of poems he said he worked on, and they were failures.
Yeah.
And they were published.
Yeah.
And he couldn't stand them.
Yeah, I agree with him. I mean, about my work, too. Yeah. About my own work. I don't. I've had this experience. Yep. Yeah. Because I'm not the same person now I was when I walked in here today. You know, so I know something more about this. I changed a couple of poems as I read them, you know. Micro. But, you know, I put a the in there, or, you know, it's just that things do change as you work your way through the poem. And the things that change are not necessarily on the page. It's in you. You know, you're changing. You get slightly different sense of what's going on here. Now, in some cases, you read something you wrote earlier. Like I right now I wouldn't write the CO poem with as much description. I'd have to be more focused on the human interaction. I'm not ashamed of it. I'm glad of it. But you know, it's not who I am anymore. That's, you know.
Thank you for your stories, because it brought in much of the political material of the era you were living in, you were writing about. Without the stories, I would not have gathered all that background information. And I value the background information. Are any of your books, do they include the backstory?
It's a wonderful question. Excuse me, that's a wonderful question. And no, the strict answer to that is no. Although, I have two ways of thinking about it. One is that if, you know, you're listening to the poem, you're sitting here listening to the poem. I know what it's like to listen to poems. You know, you get some of it. It's time. You get some of it, right? But, you know, you're listening. If you were reading, you know, and you take your time, you know, there's a little bit more of that sort of would be present. So there's that reassurance. And then the other more important thing, though, is that, yeah, I should write more. I should write some prose, too, you know. You're right. And I'm, you know, honestly and truly grateful for your presence, for the invitation. And I'm very, very grateful for Archibald MacLeish's poetry, his presence at Greenfield, his posse. Thank you.